Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English. On today's program, you will hear about a man in Zimbabwe who changed to become a conservationist. Then, Anna Matteo and Andrew Smith bring us the Health and Lifestyle Report about ways to help people with ADHD. Finally, Andrew and Jill Robbins have the lesson of the day. But first, a Zimbabwean who formerly hunted animals illegally is now in a program that turns such poachers into protectors of wildlife. 47-year-old Tembanechako Mastick grew up hunting, a tradition in his community. He also planted crops and raised farm animals or livestock. But dry weather conditions made farming less profitable, so he turned to illegal hunting, also called poaching. Then, last year, he got caught. Mastick had poached some small game from Save Valley Conservancy. It is one of the largest private game reserves in Africa. Mastick was jailed for nearly 3 months. Now he is in a program that aims to turn poachers into conservationists. Recently, Mastick was with a group of men. They found the den of some hyenas that had recently attacked livestock. The bones of the goats showed what happened. Some of the men suggested using fire to burn any hyenas remaining in the den. But Mastick warned against killing the animals, whether for revenge or for meat. He said, "I began to realize that animals are for the benefit of the entire community, so poaching is a selfish act." Spreading that message is not easy. Across southern Africa, conflict between humans and wild animals is increasing. Dry weather, illegal hunting, tree clearing, and the changing of forest to farmland have pushed wildlife closer to people. Elephants raid vegetable gardens. Lions, hyenas, wild dogs, and jackals target cattle and goats of farmers. Donkeys that work on farms are not safe either. Zimbabwe's Parks Agency said it has received 3,000 to 4,000 calls about wildlife problems in the past 3 years. Tinashe Farawo of the Zimbabwe National Parks and Wildlife Management Authority said the conflicts are likely to increase during the dry months ahead. Mastick remembers when there were good harvests of corn, millet, and cotton. The wild animals stayed in the forest back then. He said the problems began after the country's land reform program went into effect in 2000. People started farming on land held by the Save Valley Conservancy. The conservancy said it lost 30% of the wildlife habitat on its 303,000 hectares of land. At the same time, drought hit Mastick's village. Lions began targeting our livestock. Elephants also became a problem. Hyenas, too, he said. There was not enough land to feed livestock, and people from neighboring villages crossed into the reserve to get wood. Dingani Masuku of the Conservancy said all resources are scarce, so we have to compete with animals for those resources. The resources are getting leaner and leaner. Mastick often has to calm angry villagers who have lost livestock. He knows about the problem. He starts each day by counting his own cattle, goats, and donkeys. Once he had 45 goats. Now he has only 10. Wild animals have eaten the rest. Mastick himself has bites from animals, including from a leopard attack. Without crop harvests, we have to turn to livestock to raise money for school fees, food, and other necessities, so people are justified to be angry, he said. But he added, I help them understand that killing the animals is not the solution. Part of his message is that jail is difficult. His family suffered while he was in prison because he had been the family's only earner. Several of his 20 children stopped going to school. But in jail, he learned new skills, including carpentry. Now he makes chairs and tables in his workshop that have been popular with visitors and locals. Men visit his workshop, and Mastick tells them about conservation. He also speaks at village gatherings, funerals, and community meetings. There is no information about poaching in the area, but Mastick believes the number of poachers has dropped since he started his efforts. Masuku of the Conservancy said people believe Mastick and gain hope from his work as a carpenter. He said people know that he has been through it, he has been there, and that poaching does not pay, and that is why he is reforming. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
From VOA Learning English, this is the Health and Lifestyle Report. Becky Litvinchek did not think she would be able to finish the many tasks needed to start her own business. She has Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder, or ADHD. It affects every part of her life and hurts her ability to focus on one thing at a time. So, 2 years ago, she turned to artificial intelligence, or AI. She uses an app called Claude. It helps her decide which contracts are the best for her cleaning wipes business, Get Dirty. Using the app means she does not need to read each contract word for word. She also created business plans by telling the generative AI bot what her goals were. It then created steps for her to reach them. It's been just massively instrumental. I probably would not be where I am today, Litvinchek said, of using AI. People with ADHD experience difficulties
with focusing, organizing, and controlling urges. Experts say generative AI tools can help them finish tasks more quickly. However, they also warn that such tools should not replace traditional treatments for ADHD. Some experts also have concerns about possibly using AI too much. They also worry about privacy risks.
John Mitchell is an associate professor at Duke University School of Medicine in North Carolina. He said that AI apps should be used as one tool in a toolbox. AI should not take the place of traditional treatments, such as developing organizational skills or taking medications. He compared using AI to help ADHD with swimming and staying alive in the water. If you're kind of treading water in your job and AI's a life preserver, well, that's great. You're staying above water. But, he added, you still don't know how to swim.
Litvinchek, a married mother of four living in New York City, dropped out of high school and left the workforce. Research shows that these things are more likely to happen to people with ADHD. Aside from helping with her business, she uses ChatGPT to help with food shopping. Food shopping and meal planning are tasks that can be difficult for people with ADHD because these tasks require organizational skills. After sharing her method with another mom with ADHD, she decided more people needed to know about it. She started making videos on TikTok about the AI tools she uses to help with her ADHD struggles. Generative AI tools can help people with ADHD break down big tasks into smaller, more doable steps. Chatbots can offer advice for specific things and make people feel like they are talking with a real person. Some AI apps can also help with reminders and productivity. Software engineer Bram DeBeijer said he created Goblin Tools with his neurodivergent friends in mind. The tool's most popular feature is the magic to do. A user can enter a task and the bot will create a to-do list. It can even break down large items on the list into smaller tasks. I'm not trying to build a cure, DeBeijer said, but something that helps them out for 2 minutes out of the day that they would otherwise struggle with.
Russell Fulmer is a professor at Husson University in the northeastern state of Maine. He described the research around AI and ADHD as inconclusive. In other words, the results of its usefulness are still not known. Experts say they see how AI can have a positive effect on the lives of people with anxiety and ADHD. But, Fulmer said, such tools may not work well for everyone, including people of color with ADHD. He pointed to chatbot responses that have been racist and unfair toward certain groups of people at times.
Valise Jones is a publicist and founder of Sincerely Nicole Media. She was diagnosed with ADHD as a child. She uses AI bots to help with reading and responding to emails, as well as proofreading public relations plans. But chatbot responses do not always go along with who she really is. There are cadences in my writing where you can kind of pick up on the fact that I'm Southern, and that's on purpose, said Jones, who is Black. She purposefully writes in a way that shows her culture. However, the responses she gets back from bots often do not show that. Software engineer DeBijor said that using AI chatbots as a personal assistant has a big upside. They are never tired and never sleep. The downside? They also create privacy issues. When you give an AI chatbot your personal information, emails, calendar, and personal writings, you are giving it to a big company, he warned. And that's the Health and Lifestyle Report. I'm Anna Matteo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And we have Anna Matteo here with us to talk about today's Health and Lifestyle Report. Welcome, Anna.
Thanks for inviting me.
ADHD stands for Attention Deficit Hyperactivity Disorder. The U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention says the disorder is among the most commonly diagnosed neurodevelopmental disorders in children and that it lasts into adulthood. The CDC's most recent data says that 7 million children have been diagnosed with ADHD, and that doctors are twice as likely to diagnose boys with the disorder as girls. People with ADHD often have trouble focusing on finishing a task and organizing information. Is that right?
That's right. So that's where generative artificial intelligence comes in. An AI chatbot can help people with ADHD break down large tasks into small steps. It can also help them read or sort through large amounts of information.
Chatbots are computer programs that aim to produce conversations like people would. If you have used a customer service app online, you have dealt with a chatbot. Most use artificial intelligence or machine learning to expand their communication abilities. People disagree on how well chatbots communicate and present facts. Do you think chatbots have uses for people who do not have ADHD?
Actually, I don't think you have to have ADHD to benefit from an AI chatbot this way. You can give it a large, long-term goal with all the important details and ask it to break it down into small steps. I've done it, and it's fun. It's like having a personal assistant or life coach.
It looks like you're putting chatbots to good use, Anna. It's always nice to talk with you about health and lifestyle.
Thanks for having me. I really enjoy talking about this topic.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Matteo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
Welcome to the part of the broadcast where we help you do more with our series,
Let's Learn English.
The series shows Anna Matteo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
Today, we're going to use some examples from Let's Learn English to show how native speakers pronounce words when they are talking quickly. This is very important for understanding spoken English.
And it's important for learning to sound more like an advanced speaker of English.
That's right. And this is something you can listen for in many episodes of Let's Learn English.
Let's get started. What are we going to listen for first, Jill?
Whoa, slow down, Andrew. Can you ask that again a little bit slower?
Okay, sorry. I said, what are we going to listen for first, Jill?
Andrew, your question gives a perfect example. We are going to listen to the difference between slower and faster speech when we put together the words what and are. We are going to listen to some examples from Lesson 7 of Let's Learn English. Andrew, can you explain what happens to Anna in Lesson 7?
In Lesson 7, it is Anna's first day at work, and she is excited to meet people. She also wants to know what they are doing. So she asks them, "What are you doing?" However, she causes some problems by accident. Let's listen as Anna meets Anne. Anne is busy writing when Anna meets her.
Hi there, I'm Anna.
Hi Anna, I'm Anne.
Nice to meet you. What are you doing?
I'm writing.
You are writing. You are writing a lot. Oh dear.
No.
I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I'm sorry. Really.
Please stop. Please.
Sorry.
Next, Anna says hi to Jonathan, who is busy recording his show. Anna has already met Jonathan at her apartment building.
And people all around the world are waiting to hear news about the next president.
Jonathan, hi! Remember me? I live in your building.
Oh, hi, Anna.
What are you doing?
I am doing my show.
Oh, sorry. Are you recording?
Yes, and now I have to record again.
Sorry. Have a good show.
Thank you.
Sorry.
I think Anna is going to say, "I'm sorry," a lot in this episode.
Yes, she is. But let's compare the way she asked the question, "What are you doing?" in our two examples. Here's the first one.
Hi there, I'm Anna.
Hi Anna, I'm Anne.
Nice to meet you. What are you doing?
And here is the second example.
Oh, hi Anna.
What are you doing?
You can hear that Anna says, "What are you doing?" a little slower in the second example than in the first. Let's listen to the examples again, but only to the question itself.
What are you doing? What are you doing?
You can hear that Anna said it faster in the first example.
But still not as fast as you said it, Andrew, near the beginning of our lesson.
Let's rewind and hear how I said it. What are we going to listen for first, Jill? I did say it faster. So we actually have three examples. Not fast, a little fast, and really fast.
In your example, the words what and are get combined into one. Water.
Water. Water. Water. It almost sounds like water.
Yeah, that's right. But instead of wa for water, it's wa for water. And here's how our listeners can learn more about this. On the webpage for Let's Learn English Lesson 7, you can scroll down and click on the pronunciation practice video. Starting 55 seconds into the video, you can hear another example of the difference between slow and fast speech for saying the two words what and are.
That's right. And in the first part of the pronunciation practice video, you can hear another important aspect of fast speech. Many times, the ing at the end of words gets shortened to just the sound in. So if Anna were talking even faster, she would say, "What are you doing?"
I have an idea. Let's listen to how the pronunciation practice video from Lesson 7 explains this.
Is that what we're doing?
That's what we're doing. Let's hear it now.
In the present continuous tense, verbs end in ing. In careful speech, Americans pronounce the g at the end of the verb. However, in fast speech, many Americans do not pronounce the g at the end of the verb. The result sounds like this.
Writin.
Doin.
Readin.
Here is an example.
Careful speech.
I am reading a book.
Fast speech.
I'm reading a book.
Those are good examples. And the pronunciation practice video in Lesson 9 gives another useful example of how native speakers put words together quickly.
Is it about answering yes-no questions?
Yes, it is. Or maybe I should say, yes, it is.
Let's hear it.
When Americans answer a yes or no question with yes, we sometimes say the words with no break. The sounds blend together. Here's an example. Listen.
Is it sunny today?
Yes, it is sunny.
We write it like this.
Yes, it is.
We say it like this.
Yes, it is.
So those three words, yes, it is, can sound like one word.
That's right. And I think people learning English should pay careful attention to the differences between fast and slow speech. That might help them train their ears to better understand fast English.
And, of course, they should take short phrases like, what are you doing? And simply practice repeating them faster and faster until it feels natural.
It's like if you want to learn to run fast, well, at some point, you just have to try running fast.
That's true. And the more you do it, the better you'll get.
We have many more English lessons coming your way. So keep listening and exploring all of the programs on VOA Learning English. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.